Good evening, ladies, gentlemen, and everyone in between and either side. Welcome to the final of the 2018 Roller Derby World Cup, which will see USA take on England. I am Snoogans.
I am Captain Motorboater.
We are very lucky to have producing for us this evening the incredible Bobby Narko. We are preparing to get our anthems through, but right now we're going to give you a rundown of our rosters. Would you like to start?
We'll start with the United States of America, number 0260, Spin Diesel, number 10, Stephen Carter, 19 is Streak, number 20, John Wyatt, 21, Tommy Gunn, 2468 is Dylan Butts, number 3, Tony Muse, 3158 is Beastang, number 32, Shane Bauer, number 515, Michael Thornton, 618 is Bled Zeppelin, number 7, Magnum, 82 is Percy Control, 91, Patrick Lopez, 99, Defensive Destroyer.
Hey, yep, that's USA skating in the white. England will be skating in the red this evening. First up, we have 000, Omar Gerd. Number 10 is Charlie Scraplin. 100 is Alien Al. 101 is David Waterman. 17 is Sully. Number 2 is Shrooms. 21, Toots. Number 40 is Don. 5 is Fish. 60 is John Kirkham. 6283 is Spectral. 666 is Reaper. Number 7 is Thomas Banks. 747 is Scooby. And number 76 is Illbilly. So those are the skaters we're going to see on track for game 64.
Two teams that know each other quite well in men's roller derby World Cup competition. 2014 and 2016 saw both of these teams play each other. Mm-hmm. The USA on top in both. But we'll get to a national anthem first.
Thank you very much, folks. That was the national anthems for England, God Save the Queen, and for the United States of America, Star Spangled Banner.
And so, now we're 20 seconds away from the championship game, the gold medal game.
20 seconds away, 15 seconds away from the end of yet another Men's Roller Derby World Cup. And if you missed it at the end of the bronze medal game, We also had information from Statman that the fourth round of the Men's Roller Derby World Cup in 2020 will be held in St. Louis, Missouri.
St. Louis, Missouri, the gateway to America.
So to get us started in this Jam 1 first half of what's going to be incredible, we've got David Waterman, 101, as your lead jammer for England.
Very quick move to the inside. Waterman able to get through, but then Stephen Carter finds his way through the pack. Initial jam, or initial pass for both skaters.
Carter closing that gap incredibly fast. Hit from Shrooms at the end there. Let's take another look at that initial pass. So quick.
Very quick, right through the center of what was an unorganized defensive wall. 1 point each skater.
So up for England on this next jam, we have number five, Fish, up against 3158, Beastang.
Beastang looking for room to the inside, finds the opening outside. Beastang in control, approaching a scoring opportunity for the U.S.
Solid three wall on the outside line there.
Beastang got laid down upon by Shrooms on the outside there. Didn't think he was going to get up and recover fast enough without allowing any points for England, so best to call it off and re-rack.
Nice footwork there from Beastang on that outside line. Ooh. And that tumble.
There's the Shroom laydown technique.
Go to sleep.
Charlie Scraplin for England, taking on Magnum for the US.
Magnum is through, but Charlie is hot on his tail. Only about 10 feet and stretching separates these two jammers. Scraplin's had a little bit of a varied tournament. This is his second World Cup. Last time round, he played for Germany.
Little hold there by Charlie Scraplin, might have actually opened the hole there for Magnum. His blocker was trying to slide into position, and Charlie grabbed a hold of the jersey and didn't allow him to get to the hole that Magnum stepped through. Great replays by the VMix software and the whole entire crew helping us put on this production.
They've been stellar all weekend. Sully, number 17, up for England in the red.
Number 32 for the United States is Bowen.
Multiple air block being assessed to number 76, Illbilly of Team England. So that's a blocker down. Multiplayer USA, 3-on-3 pack now. So incredibly tight as we move. Of course, if I say that the pack is tight, the jammer's going to get through. They can't even hear us, Captain. Nope. It's not fair.
But Shane Bauer able to get through as well. We'll see how quickly they can catch up to the pack. Defensive destroyer fell down. That stopped the runaway and put four on the board. A first lead change.
And I get the feeling that we're going to see these increments. That is the highest jam of the game so far. 4 points on the board. Lots of hit it and quit it so far, Captain.
You see the space outside, and then the one-on-one block, just not enough room to be able to get that.
That's going to be a good photo.
Patrick Lopez for the U.S.
Waterman back up for England. Just clipped to the inside.
Already looking at a potential star pass situation for England.
That's not going to happen. Their pivot is in the penalty box. So we have pack advantage, USA.
Lopez barreling through the inside. Elliot Al hit the deck.
Waterman with the star stash to get him through the pack. Both jammers racing now.
Reaction fast and furious as anticipated. Lopez with a nice jam for the United States.
Now the 4 points on the board. Sees another lead change, 8-5 in favor of US. USA coming up for 25 minutes left of the clock. How are we only 5 minutes in? This is insane.
It's only 5 minutes, and here we are. Jam number 6 on tap. It's Stephen Carter, second time around for the United States. Take it on at number 5. That's Fish from England.
Nice takeoff there by Scooby on the outside.
Scooby gets a piece of Stephen Carter, knocks him to the ground, and forces a low block penalty. Power jam time now for England.
Yeah, that low block being incurred on Shrooms. Shrooms then going to call for a back block. Plenty of space through the pack. Fish is through, picks up lead, but we do have pack advantage in play for USA. Four blockers plays 3 as we come into turn 3.
Trying to sweep the United States there. Doesn't work out. Fish got knocked off and had to run back.
Spectral and Elbilly causing trouble for the USA blockers. Beautiful takeoff there by Bled Zipplin of Fish coming into turn 4 as we lose another blocker to the penalty box for England.
Scooby with that back block. Aerial work done by Stephen Carter. Stuck the landing. Now a dip through right center track for 5.
Don't forget, folks, Fish is your lead jammer.
He's fighting a braced 3 in the apex of 3 and 4. Defensive destroyer picks up the multiplayer for the United States of America. They'll go to the box for 30.
Both jammers are scoring now. Nice sweep and clear. Fish there going in, butt first.
Hashtag butt first.
Hashtag butt first indeed.
There goes Carter, aerial, flying with what looks like general ease. Everyone that's ever tried that knows how difficult that is, so.
I can't jump straight up and down in mm-hmm. trainers. Mm-hmm.
He has wheels on his feet, and he does it. The United States of America with a timeout after a 14-7 advantage on the jam. Waterman picking up that lead jam. Then there's B-Stang and his good footwork, narrowly avoiding a cut there on that. That's the patented Shrooms laydown technique.
I'm going to see it in Dragon's Den. That probably means not much to you guys, but there's people watching at home and will understand.
They laughed or yeah. giggled at least.
There were lols.
Lols.
With the Z on the end. Excellent. Otherwise, it just doesn't count.
Excellent.
That's what the kids tell me anyway.
I don't trust the kids. They're trying to set me up.
If they're not selling cookies, I don't want to know. This timeout brought to you by Roller Derby Elite, the brand that is the sports, rollerderbyelite.com. So we are moving back towards the end of this timeout. 22 plays 12 in favor of USA. Fresh jammers on the line. Charlie Scraplin and B-Stang. Lead jammers even going into this jam. Scraplin looking to tip it over, however, just taken off on the inside of turn 1 and set right back round past that jammer line by Streak.
Streak now one-on-one, chest-to-chest against Scraplin. Scraplin discards Streak with both hands. Picks up the lead jammer.
Two leads in a row for England. B-Stang managing to complete that initial pass. Still about half a lap behind Charlie. Charlie looking for the space.
Able to squeak 3 points out of that. Charlie landed what looked like that Oof. Skate.
That was
very,
an interesting.
Very close to not being where it needed to be.
Yes.
So he put it back into reverse and repositioned himself not to get the cut.
Mm-hmm. So it's interesting to see so far as we're moving through these jams at a rate of knots. England had been running a four-jammer rotation, which is working right quite well right now. Sully picking up a third consecutive lead jammer for England. USA running that five-jammer rotation at present. And while not currently picking up lead, they are managing to get out of the pack with quite a little bit of speed.
If this is going to be the result of this five-jammer rotation for the U.S., you might see some strategic change there. Three in a row given up by the United States defense. Shut out twice, yep. So the offense hasn't shown up.
Yep.
Save for Stephen Carter's last jam, we could have a quite different point differential right now.
Absolutely, just 3 points in it now as David Warman makes it four lead jammers in a row for England, and Esbauer is stuck in that melee of a pack moving from turn one to two. That is going to be a penalty assessed. Do you believe that was a back block to Bauer? So we're now in power jam territory for England. There's only 3 points separate these two teams right now.
Led Zeppelin with a force out. Beautiful. On Waterman and asking the rest of the pack to move back to turn two. Reset and engage for Waterman's next push.
Just two England blockers on track at the moment, two in the box.
Waterman tipped inside. Nice positional blocking, but resets that three wall, spins right around it. Tapping the hips, tapping the helmet. Jam called off.
That's going to see a lead change. Let's take another look at that first pass. Explosive contact there. Waterman clearing that blocker.
Not often you see Bled Zeppelin moved out of the way like that. But Waterman definitely has the size and the power,
yes,
to make that type of block ineffective. Little shift in jammer style now with Lopez on. Quicker, more explosive. Right now trying to utilize leverage. Directional clockwise block on Fish. Nope, forearm is that call for Fish. So it's a power jam time for Patrick Lopez.
And Lopez is your lead jammer in this jam as well. It's everything you want as a jammer, power jam, lead jam.
Especially coming off of what the U.S. has come off of, losing four straight power jams, or not power jams, lead jams.
Misconduct penalty being issued to Fish, so going to be down one blocker as, my apologies, misconduct penalty being issued to Shrooms. Fish exiting the box, so he's one blocker down to try and help him with that offense. However, Lopez has just been taken off by Scooby and recycling him right almost back to the channel line.
Lopez got back in, though, and avoided a shot by Scooby, but then gets bumped off by Don. Checks the inside for a peek to see if there's any more room over there. Star pass completed now. Jammer on record, Scooby for England.
We saw Scooby receive a couple of star passes yesterday against Canada. He was quite effective.
The bench imploring Patrick Lopez to call the jam off before Scooby got in position to score. Dylan Bott's nice block. Leaning completely all of his weight, thrusting Fish off of the track, getting a little bit of help, and then they quickly run him back to the jam line.
So we're moving into an official timeout, and obviously we mentioned at the top of the show that these two teams have faced off in the two previous Roller Derby World Cup finals. Interesting quick look at the points per jam. Quite a different story to what we've seen previously.
Yeah, there's only one double-digit score on that points per jam, and that was from Stephen Carter from the United States in jam 14. Excuse me, jam 6. No, we haven't got to 14 yet. I'm in the future.
14 points in jam 6.
Yeah, I'm in the future right now.
What's it like?
technically, we are 7 hours ahead from America, so my American audience, I am in the future.
You are in the future.
I literally am in the future.
I mean, I am in the future for my English audience, because we're an hour ahead here in Barcelona to the UK. Coming to you from the future.
So we know, like we said, from the past, the United States and England have played each other in men's Ordinary World Cup competition. The U.S. taking the first win, 260-71, beat them by 189 points. Mm-hmm. The second time they met in 2016, the United States 212-143, only a 69-point differential.
Massive close in that gap.
And now you look at this situation early on, almost halfway through period number one,
yeah,
and the differential is 7 points.
It's nothing at all. It's a pass and a half.
Now, 24 points scored by England is quite an accomplishment already, considering that the United States has only given up 81 total points in the 2018 Men's Roller Derby World Cup. Men's Roller Derby World Cup, that's easy for me to say. Fairly long conversation here. The score has not been adjusted yet, so I'm not sure what the conversation is regarding, but it is an official timeout.
We do have a fantastic alt ref working on our behalf, Empower, and she's promised to come and keep us updated with anything that may have any kind of impact. So I can see that she's just having a conversation with our in-house cohorts, Battered Sausage and Beautiful Banshee, keeping them clued into everything that's going on. And I'm fairly certain she's going to come over and have a word with our boy Bobby Narco, and he'll tell us what's going on. And we can tell you wonderful people at home. Mm-hmm.
You see a shot there, the two jammers that are about to face off. Charlie Scraplin, like we said, last Men's World Derby World Cup, played for Germany, now playing for England. And Stephen Carter, also wearing number 10.
Yes. Anybody that's heard me commentate at all for anything that Charlie Scraplin's done knows that I can wax lyrical about this guy. I'm a big fan. He started playing roller derby in my hometown of Ipswich. And just the progress from when he started to where he is now is absolutely phenomenal. But we are into this new jam. Carter taken off on the outside, quick reset. And we do have Carter as lead. He's obviously been reabsorbed into that pack. Scraplin now two wall to, well, as I say, two wall, everybody waterfalls forward and catches him up.
And you see that happening to team after team when they think they're about to approach one or two blockers. All of a sudden, the cavalry comes.
Yes. Wow.
Thomas Huge. Banks went to the box for a low block while we were talking about the exciting defensive position by the United States. And while that's going on, Stephen Carter just continues to lap, already with 10 points on this jam.
Yeah, Omar exiting the penalty box, coming on track, picking up a back block penalty almost immediately. So he's going to sit back down in that cheese ball bearing penalty box. That's cheese with a Z.
15 points now, 20 for Carter on this jam. Obviously the highest scoring jam that we've had so far.
Absolutely. Okay, so it looks like in that lengthy official timeout we had, our officials were discussing a leg block which had already been assessed on discussion and review, so to speak. It was deemed that the call stood, so no changes were made. Looks like Kirkham heading to the box for a forearms penalty. Just take another look at
Carter with a shake on the outside. Not enough foot speed to catch something moving that fast for England. That ended up being a back block by Omar.
So we've just shifted into another official timeout. This official timeout brought to you by Bruce Skate Straps. Skates just don't quite fit right. Don't let foot or heel slippage mess with your game. Check out Bruised Skate Straps. They wrap around your boot and plate to keep your feet in place so you can improve agility. Be better with Bruised Skate Straps. BruisedSN.com. Taking another look at that jam. The points per jam, nothing on the board for England for just a little while now after having that run of three consecutive leads.
Up front for the United States, Beastang working to brace three.
And that's going to be Sully pushing that two wall at the back of the pack. Sully coming out victorious. Sully having a lot of success at present jamming, and he is now on a power jam. Beastang heading to the box for a forearms penalty.
Now, there was a lot of contact with Illbilly on turn two. That was where the penalty originated for Beastang. Great opportunity for England to get this point differential back under control. But you got Thornton doing some work to try to slow that down. Illegal contact, and it is the call on Thornton.
Sully clearing the pack.
Sully ramping up the partisan crowd here in Barcelona.
I tell you what, I was going to say, I don't know if you folks can see it at home, but just as you get a shot of the pack moving around the track, it's standing room only, not even that. And what you can't see, we've described this hall for you, this Roller Derby City track, as we're basically in kind of a giant hamster cage.
A fishbowl, maybe?
Yeah, fishbowl, that works, that's even better. Glass walls all around, and there's standing room only up there as well on that balcony.
Yeah. And they've all caught an image of Beastang picking up lead jammer after getting out of the box. Waterman also with the initial pass completed for England, so forcing a quick call off. 3 points awarded to the United States.
Beastang coming out of that penalty box with explosive speed and getting right caught in there, sandwiched between Omar and Spectral. Just managed to reach his hips.
On the jam line now for the United States is Magnum. 666 is Reaper for England.
Reaper going for that inside line, tiptoeing along it, but it does slip to the inside, to the infield, sorry. So he's reset himself, and he's now got that three wall. Tommy Gunn covering him. Defensive destroyer. Oh. High block being issued to Reaper in all of his jumpy action. And so he's going to sit in that cheese ball penalty box. And now we are power jammed.
Magnum forced to the inside on a nice block by Illbilly. He'll come back and give it a whirl again, looking for some offensive help. Quickly, Botts goes in and gets low. Shrooms, maybe attempt another lay-down technique again.
Botts heading to the box, right, blocking with the head. Back block going to defensive destroyer.
So now a major pack advantage for England, and they get Reaper out of the box, flying around the team.
And Captain, we have 55 seconds remaining of this jam, and we do not yet have a lead jammer. Amazing penalty kill by England as well.
Not lead for Reaper because of the penalty? Mm-hmm. No?
Absolutely. Magnum still looking for that initial huge hit by Tommy Gunn, taking Reaper off on turn one.
Tommy Gunn not only delivered the hit, but able to avoid a block by Scooby and to get back and force that recycle.
Huge kudos to the England defense there, mm-hmm. holding Magnum for a minute and 32 seconds.
And killing a penalty.
Yes. That's multitasking.
That is multitasking. You are right. I'm going to multitask here. I'm going to talk and read at the same time. Number 101, David Waterman on the track for England in the jam position. Taking on number 32 for the United States, that's Shane Bauer.
Waterman through once again as your lead jammer.
Waterman's been extremely successful for England in the jam position.
Loose pack, making things a little easier. And we've got the United States pivot in that cheese ball bearing penalty box.
Yeah, that's Percy Control wearing the stripe. We're going to get Led Zeppelin in the penalty box as well. So a major pack advantage again for England as we start jam number 16. You're going to see the C's part once again in the middle. And Waterman just able to out race Percy Control. That's where he picked up that penalty.
And that scoring pass. Just that the slightest of shoulder drops.
Mm-hmm. Patrick Lopez on the jam line for the U.S. They get on Fish. It's a third jam for Mr. Lopez.
Fish getting physical. Pays dividends. That's going to be another lead jammer in the box for England.
Dylan Botts with a nice block. Super low center of gravity for Botts. He just gets right under the hip and then gets control.
Toots picking up a multiplayer block, followed by misconduct for not leaving the track. Nice little embrace there between Fish and Peter Pan. Points on the board for both teams.
Yeah, 2 points stolen there from Lopez. Fish lost sight of where the jammer was, so unable to get it called off quick enough.
So England really nickel and diamond this here, Captain. They're up to 40 points on the board, yet to get a double-digit jam.
Inside of 10 minutes, though, and only down 20, I think that England's okay with that position right now. As they've been able to nickel and dime, maybe one jam away from an exploding 20 or 30-point jam and
absolutely
flipping the table.
We've got two rather separated packs. Reaper throwing some incredible footwork as he does so well, trying to work his way around that United States defense. Meanwhile, Carter being taken off and recycled.
Yeah, Spectral did a great job over there, as well as Kirkham, who double-teamed, pushed Carter off, but he's able to jump back on. Has the lead jam now, already putting points on the board.
Absolutely, just Kirkham and Toots on track as blockers for England at the moment.
Another penalty from an England blocker. Looks like they'll get two out shortly, but one in. So right now, a blocker for England, a jammer for England. U.S. pivot in the box for a forearm. That was Percy Control again.
Omar back on track, offering offense. Locker and jammer having a conversation.
Carter looking for a little bit of offensive help from Spin Diesel, but Diesel's going to back up and get braced for a three wall to see if they can keep Reaper where he's at.
Meanwhile, Omar heading to the box as pivot for a clockwise penalty. Reaper nearly round on the outside line, but just straddling ever so slightly, so he's going to reset.
Carter knocked to the floor.
A lot of tumbles in that jam.
Yeah, Toots was looking for a backlock on Carter right there towards the end. Wasn't happy that it didn't get called. Kind of head shake. But a 23-point jam, just what the United States needed. The rest of the, you know, they don't have a solution for Carter. They don't have a solution defensively or offensively. But they've done very well against the other jammers for the United States.
Yes.
So England's going to probably concede that jams with Carter are going to end up like that. Can they capitalize in situations like this where they get the lead jam? What Sully got? What does the team have? How are they going to get more points generated on these opportunities?
Absolutely. B-Tank still looking and finding that initial pass. Shrooms taking a lay down on the track saying, Stang, won't you join me? Four points on the board for Sully, knocked out on turn one, opts to call the jam. Yeah.
Magnum, as we said earlier on the last jam, held for basically a minute 30. Mm. And this time going up against Charlie Scraplin. So based off of this game currently, you would say advantage England. We'll see how it unfolds.
It's definitely possible.
Plenty of room on the outside, though. After a move around Spectral, Magnum tells the announcers to shut up.
I do not care for the words that you are speaking.
Right.
Scraplin going one-on-one with 6-1-8. Led Zeppelin. Scraplin is he's a scrappy guy. I mean, don't get me wrong, but... Is Bled Zeppelin really where you want to go one-on-one? Ever?
You ducked under that shot by Streak. Almost looked like he was trying to take his head off, and Charlie still got too low.
Ooh-wee.
It's a lot of action going on.
Little
bump right there. That's going to force anybody to get a call off when they get knocked almost to the first row.
Yeah. There's some fans really getting their money's worth right now in here, in-house.
And we didn't even charge them extra.
No. The sweat is free.
They get to set, they get all of the perks of being in the front row, and we don't charge extra.
I mean, you do have to deal with it being the danger zone.
Patrick Lopez jamming for the United States. Number five is Fish for England, in case you're keeping score at home.
I recall an event some time ago. I can't remember where or when it was. Whoa, Person Control arabesquing his way out of the pack.
Patrick Lopez, lead jammer for the United States.
Star Party, Scooby for England. Second star pass to Scooby, and second star pass in this game total.
Look at this, 1 foot, one hand, no problem. I'll take lead jammer.
I tell you what, he's given the break dancers that we had at halftime a couple of evenings ago run for their money.
I saw a couple great breakdance style moves in the Mexico-Canada game.
Yes.
With a 360 backspin call-off, it was gorgeous.
The Russian judges gave it a 9.5. And
when they never score well.
No, right? 101 v10. Carter and Waterman getting straight into the throng of that pack.
Waterman's lead jam the last three times he's been out there looking for a fourth. But that brace three wall from the United States is doing its job currently.
Multiplayer block being assessed to Banks for England. Very swift move off track for him. Meanwhile, Pivot Omar recycling Carter.
Carter's going to go airborne and not stick the landing. A nice push out there by Omar.
I mean, I love a good apex jump. And I'm not saying that I'm jealous or bitter that I can't do it. But it does bring me a certain degree of joy when somebody doesn't land one.
A good apex jump is awesome. A good defense of an apex jump is even better sometimes.
Yes. Absolutely. I have schadenfreude when people fail apex jumps. Forearm penalty being assessed to one of our USA blockers.
Yeah, Bled Zeppelin caught the forearm penalty, and now Stephen Carter caught five in the sky. I think he likes what he caught better.
Yeah. That five in the sky does see USA breaking the century. 102.
You feel the tilt.
45.
Happening a little bit here. This is Omar with a nice defensive block. Throws the hip right on the hip. One skate makes it, but the other one's just not going to because the momentum stopped in midair.
Yes.
Nice slide, though, there by Carter. Even he was like, hey, good block, Omar.
So, I mean, previously we've seen that run of lead jammers for England with lots of success, but in the last five jams, they've only picked up 4 points.
B standing pushing directly in the center of their pack for the United States. Number 17, Sully in red for England, battling through and getting the initial pass as well. B-Stang quickly catching the semi-fast moving pack, skipping over everybody, putting that easy four. Shut the door. Let's have another jam. I like this chest-to-chest collision against number 40, Don, for England. Get that fourth point and tap the hips correctly to get the call off.
Tapper, tapper, tapper.
Yeah, 5-on-5 derby, 80 wheels on the track. Magnum jamming for the United States. Taking on Fish, number 5 in red.
This will be almost certainly our final jam of this half. Period clock has just hit zero. I'm sure England would love to go into the second half, into halftime, off the back of a lead and maybe some more points on the board.
After that game between France and Australia, I'm never convinced that anything's going to be the last jam until it is.
It ain't over till it's over. So Fish has not picked up lead. We do have lead for Magnum for USA, but Fish is out as he exits turn three. Pack advantage England, or rather pack advantage England. One USA blocker in the box.
Four points awarded on that final jam. That was the fifth jam, lead jam in a row for the United States. And you can see they're just starting to pile on the point. It's starting and ending with the work on Stephen Carter. They've changed the jam rotation a bit. They got him a couple more jams, and those resulted in a massive amount of points.
Yeah, it's five jams in a row where England haven't scored anything. So I'm being fed an analogy by our producer. Unfortunately, I don't play cards, so it makes no sense to me. And I'm not even going to try. I'm being told full house, aces over fours. However, folks, we've got a little bit of a treat for you this evening. We have a halftime show, and to explain everything to you, as she clears herself off track, we are going to pass over to one of our in-house cohorts, the wonderful Battered Sausage, to explain to you what it is that we're going to see. I believe so.
I've got your mic.
I'm predicting no less than four selfies taken with the free bananas from this.
So just as we await this incredibly intriguing setup, we want to give a shout out to some of our sponsors. Quad Skate Shop is Europe's original brick and mortar skate shop. Outstanding selection with a delivery guarantee.
Okay,
folks. You can also check them out online, quadrollerskateshop.com. We're going to pass over to Battered Sausage for tell us what's going on.
Good, we can all hear me now. Hooray. So just skaters, can you bear with us while we roll out some carpets? If you are on skates, please stay in your assigned areas. So next we will have the performance of Aesthetic Gymnastics team from INF Barcelona Club. This club started in 2004. They participated in 12 world championships and they've been national champion on 7 occasions. The choreography that they're preparing for this season represents life from birth until we begin to discover the world through the explosion of adolescence. And that. And the vortex of adult life until we reach old age and finally death. We hope you enjoy the performance. Give it up for our performers.
Thank you.
stages, the 2018 Men's Roller Derby World Cup Championship round. This is when the cup gets decided, when it's going to go home and who it's going to go home with. I'm Captain Motorboater.
I'm Snoogans.
We got Bobby Narco chilling on the production side. He's throwing together some stats for us that are pretty astonishing. Only 13 lead jams for the United States, 10 for England, but the point totals don't tell that story. The problem there for England, the most points they've scored in one jam has been 7.
Yeah.
While the United States have a 24 and a 23-point jam and a 14-point jam, so no double-digit scores out of 10 lead jams for England.
Yeah, it's been a tough game for them so far. No doubt about that. But they did, of course, start out giving USA a real run for their money. We can see that England are aware that there are issues. They are trying to utilize everybody at their disposal. And the two star passes that we have had in the first half were both to 747 Scooby for England. USA, no star passes yet. I say yet because you never know.
You never know.
You never know.
We've got a couple of interesting little runs. England was able to get 4 lead jams in a row. The United States responded with a couple, and then they hit a string towards the end there where not only did they get 5 lead jams in a row, but they held England scoreless through those 5.
Yeah.
And they put together something. Let's do some quick math here. 28 points in those scoreless jams. So 28-0
Very
run
nice.
For the United States to close a half.
As we move into this second half, we see England on 44, USA on 111. And just a quick look at our wonderful crowd and our points per jam. It's the information we've been feeding you, and you can clearly see we've got 3 big spikes in favor of USA, and they're going to be the predominant places where that differential has pushed.
If they're going to give up, if England's going to give up 14-point jams, 24-point jams, 23-point jams, they're going to need to put points on the board themselves.
Yes.
And they're going to have to find ways to do it either in those jams to combat the differential, or they're going to have to hope that they can draw the American jammers into some penalty trouble.
Yes.
There's a lot of ways for England to get back into this, and there are a lot of ways they have the skill sets and the experience to utilize those opportunities. They just have to capitalize.
Absolutely, and I mean, we've seen score differentials similar to this swing and change this weekend, Cap. It's that we've seen some real upsets.
You had Mexico have opportunity after opportunity to beat Canada. They had the advantage, and you looked at the sheets of information that we had, the statistics that were going, and if you read those without seeing a score, Mexico won that game.
Yes.
Until they blew up in penalties. They fell completely apart after running spectacular defense against Canada. It's not far-fetched to say that the U.S. couldn't end up in a similar scenario. It's not far-fetched to say that England couldn't put enough pressure on the U.S. to force them into that. But one thing about this United States team that is different from my opinion in 2016 and different from 2014 is this team has a sense of unity about it that I haven't seen from a group of American male skaters in a long time.
Okay.
There's been quite a bit of change from the United States, the lineup that they have here in Barcelona. England doesn't have that much change other than adding a weapon like Charlie Scraplin, let's be honest, that's a game-changing switch.
Yes.
When you put a jammer with that capability on the track. But
there has been, speaking as somebody who does a lot of UK roller derby calls, there has been a reasonable degree of change in the England squad. Previous years, we've seen them very heavily comprised of skaters from Southern Discomfort Roller Derby. We've got a really big, a much bigger mix of skaters. We've got skaters from Southern Discomfort Roller Derby, yes, but we also have a large number of skaters from Manchester Roller Derby. Although not skating today, we've also got a couple of newer people. Sparky from Teesside Skate Invaders. He was absolutely integral to the earlier games that England played this weekend. has kind of come out of nowhere.
True.
And having seen him playing for his home league sort of middle towards the end of last year, he's a solid jammer, there is no doubt about that. But you can see the impact that the England style of training has had on him, and he's just blossomed. And there are a couple of real gems like that in the squad this year. A number of really strong skaters from Lincolnshire Rolling Thunder, the Thunder Ducks. Okay. So that there has been a bit of variety. But I think the biggest ejection is from Manchester Roller Derby.
Sure.
And just while I mention Manchester Roller Derby, I want to say a massive, massive shout out and big love to the one and only Selena Vile, unable to be with us this weekend for reasons. And I just want to say, it is not the same without you, Selena. I know you've been here the last two World Cups. We really miss you, and we are sending you so much love.
While we're throwing shout-outs, I want to throw a shout-out to the St. Louis Gatekeepers stepping up and hosting Men's Roller Derby World Cup 2020 in St. Louis. That's going to be a blast.
I can't wait. Right, we're back into it, folks. We've been flapping our gums for enough time now, and we've got David Waterman and Carter up on the line. Banks sliding his way to the penalty box there. The worm is optional, folks.
Get there any way you can. Just get there and get your 30 seconds rolling.
Time doesn't start till your butt's on the seat.
There goes Carter through for that lead jam for the U.S., but Waterman has been successful in solving the defense of the United States. His initial pass is completed. That's going to force a quick call off from Carter after he gets that four.
Kirkham not quite placed in the right spot on track there to shut down Carter. Had he been, say, half a foot to the left, bam, would have shut him down.
Yep. Beastang now towing the jam line for the United States, taking on Fish from England.
Pack advantage, USA with Banks still in the box. That cheese ball bearing penalty box for England.
A quick roll and Beastang bumped off slightly to the inside. Able to get back on track quickly and attack that wall. A good two wall there by England. That's nice work done up front by Illbilly. Beastang through lead jammer, the seventh straight lead jam for the United States. And now that's starting to become an issue for England.
I did wonder, as I saw Beastang moving into that front straightaway, I was like, that looks like a mighty tight line you're working there, Stang. And it was not legal. Beastang taking seat in the box for a cut penalty. Fish now on a power jam.
Got to capitalize on these opportunities. This will be a two-minute jam, but already going the wrong direction. Fish forced off by number 21 in white. That is Tommy Gunn, a new member of Team USA from 2016.
And quite frankly, after seeing his performance at the Men's Roller Derby Association Championships last year, I am not surprised. Fish being knocked back upstream as he tries to complete that pass. Beautiful penalty kill from USA. Stang back on track now, pushing against that three wall. Shrooms with the shoulder in the chest, takes him off and takes him back.
A track cut penalty on Percy Control. I believe that's the fourth penalty for Percy Control in this contest.
Fenton Stroyer also sat in the box, meaning things have got just a little bit easier for Fish, and he does complete that scoring pass, my mistake. Five on the board, first points on the board for England since jam 18 of the previous half.
And there's your first star pass by the United States. Botts gets the star helmet cover as the whistle blows, so it was official.
Yeah, we're talking about so we've got a new jam, and we're gonna move briefly into an official timeout. This official timeout brought to you by Sucker Punch. Sucker Punch Skate Shop is the largest derby-owned and operated store in Europe, operation online and actually having a physical store. Heavily involved in the European derby community on a number of levels, we are best known for our reliable service, honest advice and competitive prices, as well as our top quality products and huge product range.
There goes Magnum quickly to the outside for lead jammer. Charlie Scrappa tries that same line. He's able to get it as well, but it looks like a multiplayer block on the jammer and a forearm on the blocker.
Scraplin now on a power jam. Makes the option to call the jam with those 5 points in the bag to put fresh legs on in the shape of Sully. So we'll take a look at slight confusion there from our USA jammer. The penalty was actually initially called coming out of turn one by one of our outside pack refs. Mm-hmm. It looked like the call wasn't heard by the jammer. So the OPR pulled back to meet the jammer ref as he came round to the straightaway once again.
Charlie Scrappa had called that jam off. I'm not sure he knew that Magnum was in the box. He peeked over his shoulder a couple of times, called it, and then had a big smile on his face.
I think that this is why he called the jam. We've got Sully out. It's first lead jammer on the board for England since jam 18. Sully, he's a jammer that's kind of got it all. He's got the speed, the agility, but he's also got the physicality to take on blockers as well.
Well, you saw him just drive straight down the straightaway.
Right?
Did I say straight seven times?
But maybe. We're getting to that point. We're so near to the end of this that some words have lost all meaning.
And the great block there. Springing Sully through. And then here's that drive. Talk about the physicality. He just goes chest to chest with Streak and drives him straight back to the pivot line and shakes it off that block.
So we've got a 60-point split right now. 120 USA, 60 England. Reaper up on the line along with Magnum. Second.
Shane Bauer shaking that floor wall. Good job by Omar. Working back and forth. And then a slick move by Kirkham to knock off the track.
Loads of contact all over the shop. All the action there on turn one. Clockwise block being issued to Alien Al as Reaper comes through as lead jammer for England.
Two and a row for England on lead jam. This one, though, going to end a little bit quicker. Bauer able to get through on the initial pass as well.
Pack is moving at a reasonable pace.
Mm-hmm.
Omar engaging with those blockers.
Good shrug there by defensive destroyer, taking Reaper off of his line, forcing a call off 1 point.
Didn't call it quick enough, however, Bauer picking up two.
That's always really unfortunate when you get lead, you're in control, you call it off, and you're upside down on the differential. Lopez taking on Fish as we roll into jam number six with 22 and a half to go in the contest. Lopez swinging around an attempted block by Shrooms. Gets that lead jam locked up for the United States.
Yeah, things being made a little bit easier as Illbilly takes a seat in the box for a multiplayer block off the straightaway. Third star pass to Scooby Zoom. Mm-hmm. 7-4-7 for England. He's laying on the crossovers. However, Lopez can see him from the back of the straightaway, makes the option to call the jam.
If you're jamming for the United States and Illbilly's in the penalty box, you know you're going to have at least a slightly easier time making your way through the pack. Hopefully Carter is understanding what limited time he has with Illbilly on the track before he attempts this jam. But Waterman out there against Carter. Waterman's been so successful in this contest.
He really has. You saying about Illbilly, loving them jammers. I just kind of caught sight of him from the penalty box. And you could just see him fixed stare at Carter on the line coming for you.
A good force off by Percy Control. Gets a recycle on Waterman. Up front, once again, lead jammer for Carter. His jammer effectiveness rate is got to be outstanding right now. I think there's only been one jam where he didn't get lead.
Yeah. Carter through with the natural grand slam. Waterman has removed the jammer helmet cover. I don't think he's realized that his pivot is in the penalty box.
Carter,
fun fact for you.
Carter's got that 1 foot spinorama working today. The only jams Carter didn't get lead on, my buddy Bobby Darko told me, was the first jam of the contest. So maybe he was just a little nervous. We got that all worked out.
Highest scoring jam of the half there. 14 points on the board for USA. There's that 1 foot butt first movement. It's a thing now, folks.
Hashtag butt first.
Yeah. Sully once again picks up lead jammer for England. Beastang is out as well. And just look at the speed on this guy.
There's trash on the track and his pivot cover for the United States has fallen off.
Two unanswered points for England.
Looks like Streak lost his laundry there.
Big, big love for these replays. Replays powered by vMix live streaming software, vmix.com. All of our replays this weekend have been brought to you by vMix software. And on that note, a huge thank you to our illustrious studio crew who have kept us looking so incredibly professional this weekend. Much love to you guys.
Magnum outside, lead jammer. Charlie Scrapp went through and right on the heels.
Charlie Scraplin giving chase and forcing the call off there. Didn't manage to stop the points going on though. Four more on the board for USA.
As you can see on the screen, 144 to 63 in 18 minutes, 40 some seconds to go. Period number two, jam number 10. Fish towing the jam line. Shane Bauer is jamming for the United States.
And Fish is jamming for England. Bauer has picked up a multiplayer block, the lesser spotted jammer multiplayer, which means we're now in power jam territory for England. If they are able to capitalize, blockers going full offense.
See if Spin Diesel and Bled Zeppelin, Streak and Thornton are up to task in killing this penalty. So far, so good for the United States, but a forearm penalty sends Spin Diesel to the box.
Well, that's one less thing to worry about.
Bauer's now back on the track. Push the brace three. Trying to spin.
And there it is. Lead was still open. Fish is your lead jammer.
Pivot cover on the ground again in back-to-back jams for the U.S.
It looked for a moment like Bauer was going to go for to remove his helmet cover to star pass. Couldn't see his pivot.
Yeah.
Because the cover was on the floor.
It's been an issue for a lot of different teams over this four-day contest, but hasn't reared its head until the last two jams for the U.S. We'll see if they can get that resolved. But Reaper, wearing red, three sixes on his back. He jams for England. Patrick Lopez, he wears 915 on his back, and he's jamming for the United States.
I'm so glad you said that, because that's exactly what I've got on my paperwork. It all tallies up, it's fine. Tommy Gunn with a multiplayer block. heading back. It's just a pack of multiplayers. Cheese ball bearing penalty box, enjoying a couple of blockers there, one from each team. Multiplayer blocks for multiple players. I think that's probably a word that doesn't have any meaning anymore.
Anybody who doesn't know roller derby and they hear the term multiplayer block is confusing.
Yes. So a forearms penalty being assessed to Lopez.
So we're probably going to get a replay on this, but Dylan Bott's helmet cover hits the ground for England. Dylan Bott's walks over and just basically squats over the helmet cover, you know, hoping to get difficult for the jammer to pick back up.
It's a perfectly legal move.
Alien Al didn't really like the position there, and so he blasted Bott's in the rib cage.
And it was ill Billy with the bust. Oh, no.
No. You'll see once it hits the ground.
I was fixated on that.
Bots figures out that the panties hit the ground. And so he does a little squat there. Alien out right next to him. And he doesn't like the position. So he drops the hammer.
Sweep. Ends up taking out ill Billy. And that's where the contact ends up. That's what we're dealing with at the moment. Play is stopped while our medics take care of that situation. I mean, as we're all aware, roller derby is a full contact sport. Accidents sometimes do happen, but the safety and well-being of our skaters and officials is always top of the list. The medics we've had this weekend have been absolutely fantastic, tending to all sorts of events. And they're always incredibly quick to attend to our skaters to make sure everybody's okay. So we're just having a look at some of our previous action.
Yeah, there's another instance where off with your head cover.
Pop. It's like a champagne cork. Mm-hmm. Other bubbly beverages are available. Interesting to see a fish using some of that sort of rotatory movement that we've seen primarily, but standout memories for me is Mr. Testosterone from Canada.
Yeah, he's a human tornado.
I love it.
We have not only is he a tornado of physical specimenness, if that's even a word,
we'll go with that.
But he is living and breathing the power of positivity everywhere that he goes.
Yeah.
He really might be the most happy, energetic, positive roller derby player that you come across.
With what is quite frankly a top-notch beard. It's win-win. So our down skater has made their way back to the box. Their bench of their own volition, which is what we always want to see. The medics will, of course, continue to tend to make sure that everybody is okay. We're probably just going to take a couple of moments before we get back to the action at hand. So a quick shout to Roller Derby Elite. So much they've done for us this weekend. Roller Derby Elite continues to match luxury with technology. Whether you play in a competitive league or skate in the street with your friends, it's all about the experience. So get out there and skate. RollerDerbyElite.com.
Point differentials on the screen for you to take a peek at. You see the spikes. You see where the United States is having its moments where it's been able to really put a large number of points on the board. England still searching for that first double-digit jam. Been as high as 9, but unable to crack that magic double-digit mark.
So we've got 15 minutes and 51 seconds left on our period clock. 144 plays 65 to in favor of USA.
It's only 15 minutes and 51 seconds left of this tournament.
Yeah. Well, yeah, if you're just tuning in, folks, where have you been?
Yeah.
You've missed some incredible sportsing.
I mean, I can understand that for wherever you might be currently, Barcelona might sound very far away, but your digital device have always been right by your side.
Yeah.
You should have logged on. You should have bought the feed earlier. The action you've already missed. You're never going to get it back.
Yeah.
Unless it's replays, of course.
Well, yeah, yeah. I mean, if you didn't purchase the feed, so basically this is for the people who are currently sat at home smug watching the feed so they can tell their friends who didn't get the feed. Everything will be available to review in around about 30 days. I know I certainly will be sharing the links when everything goes live for all my friends who weren't able to attend or pick up a pass. So do make sure you keep an eye on that. We're going to be sharing that across social media.
Now that the injury to the down skater has passed, we have the official team in conference. There's going to be some conversation about that contact. What's the legality of that contact?
Yeah.
Well, in the entire scrum, what went unnoticed from my vantage point was the penalty to Patrick Lopez that's put him in the box. And we're looking at a power start now.
Yes.
For England, but we don't know if that's going to be the case, or at least how many skaters are going to power start with,
yes,
based on the contact that we saw against bots. Three jams in a row with a U.S. jammer in the penalty box. So opportunities are popping up for England. We'll see how they capitalize in this potential.
We're just going to throw it over to our ref.
On the officials' discussion, at the beginning of that action, there was a back block on the white blocker 1-2. They will serve a 30-second penalty for a back block. After the back block, red 1-0-0 recovered their balance, took strides into a leaping contact on the white blocker. The red blocker will be expelled for the egregious leaping contact.
And there we have it. That block. Yeah. That block that Alien Al delivered to Bots, causing the injury, was a leaping block that was determined to be egregious, and he'll be out of the contest. And a correction on the referee there. There is no white 2-1. White 1-2. There is a white 2-1, and that's Tommy Gunn, who received the back block penalty at the beginning of the jam. So
yeah.
I think we're all squared away on who's got what, where, and how.
Yeah, so it's a double impact outcome from that official's discussion.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to start with a considerably smaller pack on track at the beginning of this power start. Three USA blockers against two English blockers. We do have number 60, Kirkham, standing in the penalty box, so he will be joining the rest of the English pack on track shortly after the jam begins.
Some more updating still happening from officials to coaches, making sure that everything is stretched. I think part of the conversation there was probably talking about helmet covers and you know,
very possibly
them being affixed properly before stepping onto the track.
Yeah,
making sure that, you know, we don't get into these situations where we've got laundry on the floor.
Yes. Just a quick reminder, folks, although we only have 15 minutes and 51 seconds of this game left, it's not quite the end of the tournament.
Not quite.
We still have the medal ceremony, as well as the announcement of the MVP team, mm-hmm, as selected by our studio crew. Right now, however, we've got jam in play, and Sully is your lead jammer on this power start in favor of England.
Lopez standing in the box, awaiting release. Brace three up front for the United States. Sully trying to solve it. Brace three in the back for England. Lopez reaching out to streak. Simulated a star pass. Did not actually complete the star pass. That fake worked out in their favor. Lopez, first pass done.
Sully now, once again, one-on-one. number 19 streak. They've got a bit of a thing going on.
Yeah, Sully on that last blocker evade to the United States bench looked like he committed a forearm, because every skater on that bench threw up the forearm hand signal, but no harm, no foul. Shrooms hit with a misconduct penalty.
Some big old hits being thrown on track captain.
I don't think that the two sides are super stoked with each other right now, especially after that hit. I think the United States have taken a little bit of exception to that, but England's not going to back down to physical play. They'll ramp it up just as quick as the United States will. So,
oh, you better believe it.
We can just assume that the action will just get a little bit more physical.
Sully taking a hit there and tumbling off track, but recovering.
4 points awarded to Lopez on that pass. Whistles have blown all over, suggesting that the jam is over. Nice move there by Sully. Sully and Waterman both have been extremely successful when they've been out there. Still haven't cracked that double-digit point score, though.
They have not.
That one was an eight-point opportunity for England to the U.S.'s nine.
Waterman, one blocker left to pass, who he invites to sit in the danger zone with our spectators. So Waterman through as lead. Carter still caught up in the pack.
Only the second time Carter did not get lead jammer. And it's not a surprise that Waterman is the one who's done it. Waterman looking for some points. Only sees one finger in the air. One's better than none, especially when you throw a zero at the United States. So
absolutely.
Unanswered points is what it's about. And just chucking people out of his way.
Powered by burgers. It's fact. Should have seen the glee on his Facebook post when he realized that where he was staying this week is situated above a really nice burger joint.
Man after my own heart or stomach or whatever that is.
So we've got Fish and Beastank as your active jammers in this jam. Fish being recycled almost back to the jammer line. Beastang, however, rotating his way through the pack to pick up lead for USA.
Beastang tries to go aerial, but Bled Zeppelin was Owen Blocker standing in his way. Bled Zeppelin took a shot, but positions himself to absorb a hit by Scooby after the star pass from England. That split second decision where Beastang decided to go airborne and saw that he was going to crash right into a tower of Bled Zeppelin.
No.
I instantly regret this decision.
No points on the board there. Second time that's happened so far this half. Magnum and Scraplin up to jam. Scraplin throwing himself around with slightly controlled but yet equally reckless abandon.
Bots back on the track after taking that hit that knocked him out for a few jams. Once you receive medical attention, you have to sit at least three.
Exactly.
And so
Scraplin not quite through. It's actually going to be a cut penalty. Magnum still, so lead still open. Well, it's Magnum's now.
Yep. Magnum battling for a solid 35 seconds and able to get through. Now the pack sprints to turn three and four.
That is a swift pack.
Banks gets trapped in the back by the United States blockers, forcing everybody to be out of play, and that'll get five up in the air quite quickly.
So we've frozen Charlie Scraplin into the penalty box, so he's going to start from that cheese ball bearing spot. And we're going to start on a power start for USA.
There's Strapland being told of the cut track penalty, and he salutes the referee for giving it to him. Thank you very much. I'll have another.
He is so polite.
Yeah. Exited the track in a timely manner.
Uh-huh. England with just the 1 point on the board in the last four jams as they move into this power start. I was going to say, I don't think USA have noticed that Scrappling's back on track. And regardless of whether they have noticed, he's out of the box. He's through the pack. He is your lead jammer.
Bauer also getting through on the initial pass, so we'll see how long Charlie lets this go. And if the U.S. can sit down on Charlie and limit the amount of points, that's going to be a low block by Bud Zeppelin. Nope, no call on that. I did not predict the correct future. No penalty out of that exchange. Well, yeah, there's your sneaky Charlie coming on the track and just showing up. But there, I thought there was going to be a low block.
Boing.
Look at Charlie flying backwards.
I'm sorry. I shouldn't laugh. But when you replay it like that, I can't help it.
Anything happening in reverse is always going to get a laugh.
So we are having an official review as called by USA. 8 minutes, 38 left on the clock. Once we have the information from that, it will, of course, get passed back.
This official review is brought to you by Roller Derby Elite, for the proud sponsors of the Worldwide Derby and the platinum sponsor of Team USA. I'm sure Team USA is pretty excited to have them as a sponsor and be here at the Men's Roller Derby World Cup 2018. So check out Roller Derby Elite at rollerderbyelite.com for all of your official Roller Derby Elite stuff.
And don't forget, folks, if you've not been able to tempt your friends or convince your friends to buy you any of the wonderful MRDWC merchandise that's been available from Roller Derby City this weekend, give them a couple of days to update all of their stock, but it will be available online after the event has ended, so you can still grab yourself a little piece of the action.
Taking home a lot of pieces of the action this week.
Yeah.
I got a sweet patch. I got a little merch, silly.
Got a nice new top.
I got me a couple of things to wear. I got the kids some stuff.
I have had a lot of pastries.
The pastries here are good.
I had one this morning, which I'm referring to as pastry, because it was approximately the size of my face.
Was that the one with the chocolate cover on the top and filled
with what? No, this was kind of lemony. It was pleasant.
I had one that was chocolate dipped.
Yeah, that's
and then in the inside, it was basically chocolate pudding. And you can't go wrong with pudding on anything, in anything, anything.
I feel like I'm kind of, or I say kind of, or that I'm going to. I've definitely developed a reputation for myself of just veering off to talk about food when there's spare time in a call.
Sure. Here's some highlights that aren't food related.
I really thought you were about to do some food highlights. It's like, I had some great tacos last night.
We can sit here after the stream, if anybody all over the world where you're watching, if you want me to just riff on all the great things that I've eaten in Barcelona.
I mean, we can talk to the studio guys, see if they can set up like an official review food edition.
Sure.
Everyone can leave, go to the after party.
Forget highlights of Derby. Let's talk about highlights of
I have
food
some
and
photos
beverage.
Of what I've eaten. I'm that person.
If you're friends with me on any social media, you're sick and tired of the things that I posted food related. All right, let's talk about Derby stuff, all right?
And Quaddy, they didn't stand a chance. Sausage roll's no good.
What say you, head referee?
The white team is looking for a leaping contact on the red jammer coming out of the box to enter the wall. Upon review, the leaping contact had no impact. Afterwards, the jammer stepped and spun around the wall. The no call will stand.
Thank you very much to our head referee for this game. Some wonderful, concise explanations from our head refs this tournament.
So England on that jam, 2 points scored. Only 10 points combined in the last five jams. So scoring's come to a screeching halt. But that's just how England's going to have to keep the U.S. within its, you know, striking distance.
Indeed, we have a pack advantage to USA. Three blockers placed two. However, Reaper cares not for your advantage. He is lead, but he's been reabsorbed into the pack.
Reaper, the track, and engaged in blocking with Lopez. Now, finally, here's the infraction. But then Lopez, skate comes untied at the start of the power jam. If that's me, I'm calling it right there and getting fresh legs for the power jam.
But Lopez isn't lead. Reaper was.
I don't know how Reaper got lead and the cut track at the same time, though.
Separate events. Mm. Reaper got lead on coming out of turn one, got knocked off, recycled, and it was trying to go through again on the inside of turn one that incurred the cut. Yeah, it pays to be environmentally friendly. Mm.
Recycling 101.
Going a bit Mr. Burns there. Recycling. Mm-hmm. Three jams in a row. England have had a jammer in that cheese ball bearing penalty box. Reaper is back out, though. Incredible penalty kill from England this time around. That's snug. Banks going in and just wrecking some stuff up.
Holes getting opened up all over the place, so Lopez was able to get through for five. This time Reaper
finally managed to complete the initial pass. Of course, the lead reabsorption.
Sure. Whenever anybody says reabsorption, my brain immediately goes to the movie The Blob. You know?
Isn't that really what a roller derby pack is? It's just a giant blob. I'm sorry that I made that noise happen in your faces, folks at home. I'm really sorry.
So in this action right here was when Reaper was told about the track cut.
Yes.
So again, leeway is important from a good referee who made the call, you know, half a track ago, but was able to, you know, communicate that in such a way that didn't lead to a second penalty.
Indeed. So we've reset for a fresh jam. Carter and Sully donning the stars.
We're 5-on-5, 80 wheels on the track.
I was going to acknowledge Bobby's comment, because we've got additional voices in our ears, folks, but I didn't want to say anything because, you know, curse of the announcer.
Uh-huh.
See?
Yeah.
You say we've got everyone on the track, blocker goes.
You have to take advantage of it while it's there because it's not going to happen and be that way for very long. 5 points awarded to the United States on that pass. Stephen Carter. Sully threw on the initial pass for England, so Carter's going to be thinking about calling this quickly. And there it goes.
Yeah. Some less than ideal placement from Carter's blockers, however. One of them threw a hit to, I believe it was to Don, and ended up just shifting him into Carter's line of motion.
USA's lead has now hit the century mark after that 9-point scoring jam from Stephen Carter. Inside of 5 minutes now, it's do or die time, as they say, for England. If they have a run in them, they need it to come.
Waterman and Beastang, not a pairing we've seen yet so far for jamming. And
Beastang
is
gets
lead.
The lead.
As Waterman heads to the box.
Yeah, but cut track for Waterman. Five points on that pass.
Beastang telling his pack to keep moving, yep. Get it to the front.
Get to the front, open up a hole that he can get through, but Spectral braced up with Banks.
Spectral so great at that backwards brace, controlling the pack.
Spectral took a shot to the hand, shaking it vigorously.
I think he might have got a digit trapped between people.
Yeah, there was a collision in his hand. He immediately reached for it and got off the track.
So USA freezing Waterman into the penalty box. I guess we've got an ice tray. Oh.
Power start time for Magnum. Waterman standing in the box, so is Defensive Destroyer for USA. There goes Magnum exploding through the pack, picking up that lead jammer spot. Carrying some speed. Brisk pack. Waterman steps through on the initial pass.
Star Stash. Excuse me.
Scoring and tapping at the same time as Magnum as he collects the four he was looking for.
Oh, he does indeed.
Blood Zeppelin here reaching out to Magnum in case he wanted a whip. Magnum was very content to get that called off because Waterman's initial pass was completed.
So he's moving to this next jam with Charlie Scraplin and Bauer as your active jammers. It's been round about eight jams since England have put some stuff up other than blockers into the box. Both teams with somebody sat in the box. Scraplin rolling with the punches there to complete that initial pass, not too long after Bauer, and he's chasing him down.
Bauer hits, then quits. Let's see if Scraplin got through with nothing. Bit of a surprise there. It looked like he was close, but.
Yeah.
Look at that. Dylan Botts, easily the smallest person on the track for either team and still one of the most effective blockers.
Fish and Lopez sharing that jammer line for the time being. Micro pack on track, just five blockers, two English, three United States. Got any fives? Go Fish, leave jammer.
Fish just sprung right through that pack, almost undetected.
Thus breaking a four lead streak for the US. Fish tangled up in that pack.
Pat Lopez pushing that two wall. Multiplayer block on Peter Pan. He goes to the box, so no pivot for the United States.
Toots currently running some aggressive offense for his jammer. Four plays three, a jam one for England.
A timeout now for England. Good spot for that with the USA sitting at almost 200, 198 to 81.
That
only 18 seconds left in the contest.
I was gonna say that'll be why England have presumably called that jam, called that timeout. Sorry. Mm-hmm. England's still looking to put double digits onto the scoreboard in a jam. Will this be the one?
And the story of the contest really has been the defense of the United States. It's not, you know, the flashy offensive explosions that you've seen from them in the past. I mean, Carter obviously was some great offensive work in this game, but it's the defense. It's the lockdown single digit per jam defense that the United States has implored on England and brought them to this victory that they're going to take in the 2018 Men's World Derby World Cup.
And just for the record, folks, what you can hear is the England fans chanting the na-na-na of the that old classic, Vindaloo. So we're going to have this rematch of Carter v. Waterman. The way we started the game is how we're going to close it, and it's going to be the same. Waterman is your lead jammer. Carter still caught
Waterman has bested Carter three times in this game. The only person to do it.
It's got to feel good.
He's going to probably rub that in Stephen Carter's face for a little while. And he deserves it. So not that Carter deserves to have it in his face, but Waterman deserves to be able to celebrate those small victories.
Absolutely. Omar taking on Carter. Carter sweeping the leg over the kind of hips and back of Omar.
That move even got the applause of the partisan English crowd.
Yeah.
And now the celebration is on. For the effort from England in this contest, the crowd very happy of what they've seen all weekend long, all tournament long by all the teams. The United States taking the victory 203-85.
That is, of course, our current unofficial score. We will confirm that for you once all the paperwork has been signed.
Mm-hmm.
Captain, how beautiful is that?
It was a great game, and you know, the United States playing England three times in a row in this tournament, ending up taking gold each time, ended up scoring 200 points each time. But I think what the United States is really going to take away from this is their defense was the way they expected it to be.
Yeah. And that is our official final score, 203-85. USA, your champions of the world once again. England, however, can take a small victory. They have bested the points scored against USA for the whole tournament.
I think we're going to take it over to the studio in just a moment.
Absolutely. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, children and people of all ages and genders, thank you very much for being here with us. We are going to pass over to our official review crew in the studio. Thank you very much.